Yes. Oh. So, the question is, what happened during surgery in terms of respiratory modification during all the process and mainly during intraoperative? Then, first of all, as in general anesthesia, you will use anesthesia drug and mainly you have the effect of the residual effect of analgesia and anesthetic drug. Then the impact, several impact, one of the main impact are the decrease of the strength of the cough. Secondly, you have a decrease of the patency of the upper airway. And then you have also the effect of the pain due mainly to the stress of the surgery. And more, you have, as you know, and the main modification will be that so-called the restrictive syndrome. What means restrictive syndrome? Is a decrease of all the lung of volumes, the lung volumes, and mainly the vital capacity, the functional residual capacity, and the tidal volume. This restrictive syndrome leads to be associated to a diaphragm dysfunction with atelectasis. This is a vicious circle. More you have atelectasis, more you have diaphragm dysfunction, and more you have the decrease of the lung volume. And then, please note that this vicious circle, you should try to cut it after surgery and to transform this vicious circle band and a virtuous circle using probably non-invasive ventilatory support. Then associated to this modification, you also have sometimes the overfluid due to the need of fluid loading during surgery. And all this modification leads to have hypoxemia. And this hypoxemia, as you know, it leads to respiratory failure. And usually, as you know, atelectasis makes the bed of pulmonary infection. Then this slide summarizes the main modification of the respiratory function and the main point that you try to have an impact in terms of therapeutic strategy. So just a slide to remember in terms of physiology and physiopathology approaches. Always you should take into account when you speak about the respiratory system, but three main functions. First of all, as you see on this slide, you have the function airway, the airway function. The second is the gas exchange, mainly in the lungs. And the third one is the muscle pump, mainly assured by the diaphragm, which allows the ventilation, that means is the CO2 clearance. So, in a physiological situation, this allows to maintain a physiological range of gas exchange. However, when you have a dysfunction of one of the three main functions, mainly due, for example, to surgery procedure, what happens? You can have a dysfunction of gas exchange, and the surrogate of a dysfunction of main gas exchange function is mainly hypoxemia. And then the first strategy is to have oxygenation. And the oxygenation is related to FiO2 and PEEP that we will show after. And you should monitor it by PO2 and pulse oxygen saturation. This is a major issue. The second one is the diaphragm and mainly the muscle pump dysfunction, which leads to a hypercapnia. The hypercapnia is a surrogate of the alveolar hypoventilation. And then the treatment will be ventilation. And please consider that oxygenation and ventilation is totally different. Oxygenation, then you give oxygenation to the lung and all the organ. And ventilation means you have a CO2 clearance, then you should to eliminate CO2 production. And this is related to the minute ventilation, which is the product of respiratory rate, as you know, multiplied by tidal volume. And this should be monitored by the untidal CO2 and the pCO2. And you have another one that sometimes is forget, is the function airway, and that we always forget the impact of the upper airway. This is probably, it's really poorly studied in the literature, as probably in the post-operative period you have like an apneic obstructive syndrome, a decrease of this very early after surgery, And mainly, one of the other actions of positive pressure ventilation is probably one of these. We can discuss after, and then we observe sometimes some improvement, and mainly in, as we shown this morning, in obese patients with obstructive pneumonia. This, remember, it's explained probably the mechanism, and Audrey, in the next presentation, will better focus on this. So, how we can use the ventilator support management is probably you have a different approach. One called the curative approach. This is the therapeutic one. One is prophylactic or preventive. The curative one is try after surgery, after extubation, to avoid reintubation in a patient who acute respiratory failure is present. However, the prophylactic approach or preventive approach is try to prevent the occurrence of acute respiratory failure in a patient without signs of acute respiratory failure. Then the objective is just to be before the occurrence of acute respiratory failure, that the objective is to avoid it. So, obviously, you have a large gray zone, that means a patient at the morning maybe in the part of curative treatment and could be prophylactic the afternoon and change. This is a, we should be absolutely aware about this. So, in each situation, you have three main strategy, as we called it, is the high flow oxygen therapy, that is oxygen with high flow. And then you have the CPAP with one pressure, means continuous positive airway pressure, and non-invasive ventilation and two pressure. And Audrey should develop this aspect. The main mechanism probably can summarize easily by the 7 points. Using non-invasive ventilatory support, probably you can increase the FiO2, decrease the inspiratory effort, also the work of breathing, increase minute ventilation, as the machine acts as a accessory muscle, decrease dyspnea and comfort improvement. So all this leads to alveolar recruitment or prevent atelectasis formation. Then I also suspect and speculate strongly that also maintain the patency of upper airway in some selected patient with upper airway obstruction. And also you have an improvement of cardiac output in some patient after surgery with an over fluid loading. So this main mechanism can explain the improvement observed. This slide will be presented probably in more detail with Audrey. Just from the left to the right, you have a light oxygenation depression, that means light hypoxemia, and more you go to the right, you have here more hypoxemia, and this is the frontier between hypoxemia due only to the oxygenation defect, and this is muscles failure, that means you have a hypercapnia and you need a machine to assure ventilation. So Audrey will develop this part after probably. So just to see what happens when you use high PEEP or low PEEP. This is a simple physiological pathology that if you use low PEEP, maybe it's probably very good to avoid, as you see here, hyperinflation. However, if you use low PEEP, you cannot treat or prevent atelectasis. In contrast, when you use a high PEEP, it's probably good to prevent the occurrence of atelectasis. However, the risk is to induce hyperinflation. Then probably what is a good PEEP level? This is a question. And as the recent nice paper from Jean-Michel Constantin, probably the future should be to have a personalized PEEP both in non-invasive ventilation and in invasive ventilation, probably in my point of view, not only in ARDS patients, but both in ARDS and non-ARDS patients. And this is the future need to have a personalized PEEP for all the patients. So my major five keys for an AV success we will discuss also is the right indication, and then Antonio, we will see it after. The expertise and the experience of the team, this is a major issue. The correct setting, as you should probably avoid high insufflation pressure, high tidal volume to avoid volobarotrauma and to avoid discomfort. Secondly, the material, including ventilators, interfaces, humidification devices, and probably to know that stop early if non-improvement and not to delay intubation. This is my main and last slide. Please always consider all patients who developed post-acute respiratory failure after surgery, especially in abdominal surgery, please, before make anything, never forget that non-invasive ventilator support is a symptomatic treatment, and you should before have an etiologic treatment. If you should avoid a surgical complication before do anything to avoid to delay the reintervention. And then non-invasive ventilatory support, whatever, every time you should please not delay the time of reintubation. In conclusion, if you have a patient who have clinical and gas exchange improvement, yes, you can follow the non-invasive ventilatory support. However, if you have no clinical and gas exchange improvement, just after 1 or 2 hours, please stop and consider intubation to the patient. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Samir. I think you perfectly stressed the background of the ISAISIN guideline on perioperative non-invasive oxygenation, which is the main topic of our session. My proposal is to move on to the Audrey talk to discuss about what are the devices available to take care of our patient. Maybe one short question, Samir. Could you, in 30 seconds, tell us more about the prevention of upper airway disease due to with positive invasive pressure?
Yeah, this is a good point. You have the classical approach that very early, means just after extubation, mainly in the post-anesthesia care, and then you should absolutely consider the end of the effect of the anesthetic drug. As you know very well, as we are anesthesiologists, that you should probably consider the end of the effect of the mure action, and probably you should antagonize the mure action. That is the first step, never forget the first step, and you're absolutely right to remember this major issue.
This is the first part. Yeah.
This is a major recommendation. Then never, obviously, extubate a patient with the risk without any rest effect of residual cauterization. So just if you eliminate this first early complication, probably we have some data that probably morphinic effect is sometimes delayed, that we now we should always consider the OFA, as we discussed this morning, then opioid-free anesthesia analgesia for the future. And then in some patient, and probably the obese patient, always consider and positive airway pressure, that you can just win, I don't know, 10 or 20% of the diameter of the upper airway, and probably you decrease the airway resistance that can improve the work of breathing, the part of the resistive part, and probably what you can observe in some patient by CPAP or to maintain the patency.
Okay, thanks so much for this answer.